New videos every day.
I like to know things.
Hi, my name's Crystal. I graduated from Texas A&M University with a degree in agricultural leadership and development with emphasis in genetics and biochemistry. I also researched in several labs on campus in genetics. And today I'm going to talk about some very interesting facts about genetics that you probably don't know. Now, you probably think that the human genome size is rather large, which it is because we are a very complex mammal. In fact, it will fill up 90 volumes of an Encyclopedia Britannica. Now, why don't we compare that to something else? Let's say a lily seed. A lily seed actually is bigger than our genome. Its genome would fill up 1,800 volumes of the Encyclopedia Britannica. Now, we normally think that the human genome is this huge, vast information. But actually, if we converted it into binary code, the human genome is just slightly larger than that of the storage capacity of a CD-ROM. As a matter of fact, Windows XP is twice as large as our human genome. So the human genome actually requires 750 megabytes of storage, whereas Windows XP would require 1,500 megabytes of storage. So as you can see, Windows XP actually requires twice the storage as the human genome. In computer terms, the human genome is stored in 6-bit combinations of information. The PlayStation 3 is 128 bits. Now, something really interesting is that the pufferfish, isn't it adorable, actually has no junk DNA, which is interesting because humans are actually made up of 95% junk DNA, so there are organisms out there that don't have any junk DNA whatsoever. Well, one thing that researchers are particularly interested in is finding out what is junk DNA and does it actually do anything? One recent study suggests that it really doesn't. Researchers took 2.3 million letters of DNA out of a mouse and compared it to a mouse with full-length version of DNA and found out that there are no differences whatsoever. So far, we've talked about the human genome size. Well, now we're going to talk about the actual number of genes that we have in our genome. And a gene is actually just a section of our overall genome that helps the body to know how to code for specific proteins within our body. So now we're going to talk about how many genes you have compared to the number of genes that other organisms have. Now, when scientists first started to study genetics in the human genome, we actually expected to find 3 times more the number of genes than we actually found, which is rather interesting because the 20 to 25,000 genes that we did find is only about twice the number that a roundworm has. And in fact, there's a variety of an amoeba that has 200 times the number of genes that a human being has. Now, when scientists first started studying the human genome, we thought that each gene coded for one protein, but actually we have about 250,000 proteins being coded by 25,000 different genes, which means that each gene is coding for approximately 10 proteins, and scientists have no idea how this occurs. Now, as human beings, we always consider ourselves pretty complex compared to other organisms, but if we compare ourselves to coral, we actually have approximately the same number of genes as coral does. Now, you're probably thinking, I'm a human, I have to have a ton of genes, and we do. We have 20 to 25,000 genes, but you know what? A grain of rice actually has 40 to 50,000 genes. Can you imagine a little grain of rice has 50,000 genes and we have 25? What's up with that? As a matter of fact, many plants actually have more genes and much more complex genomes than many complex mammals. Now, fruit fly has about 13,500 genes. A nematode is going to have about 20,000. A human has in between 20 to 25,000 genes. A pufferfish has approximately 21,000 genes. Then we get to the Thalecrest, which has right about 25,500 genes. And then rice actually has 40 to 50,000 genes. And in fact, there's a variety of an amoeba that has 200 times the number of genes that a human being has. The smallest genome for a true living organism that's capable of reproduction is actually just 1.4 million base pairs. So now we're going to talk about the similarities of our genes compared to the genes of other organisms. Genes code for proteins, and as you can imagine, what our bones are made out of are probably going to be pretty similar to those of chimpanzees and even, say, fish. So our genes compared to, say, a chimpanzee is approximately 98% similar. We have about 98% of the same genes as the chimpanzees have. Now, what you may not know is that we are actually really similar to mice as well. In fact, 75% of our genes are in common with mice. Now, let's look at a dog. A dog's genetic sequence is actually about 85% similar to a human being's genetic sequence. Now, let's think about sea urchins. They're small, they're spiny, no bones. They don't really look anything like us, do they? Well, actually, compared to the human genes, they have 7,000 genes in common with us, which is approximately a quarter of all of our genes. Now, if you remember, I mentioned that humans have in between 20 to 25,000 genes. Now, let's think about how many unique genes they have compared to mice. Humans, in fact, only have 300 unique genes that mice don't have. So out of the 25,000 genes that we have, only 300 are not found in mice. Now, there are 113 genes that have been transferred from bacteria. Can you imagine? Bacteria! 113 of our genes are from bacteria. There are about 250 unique human genes that are not found in any lower species. In fact, scientists have not been able to find any evolutionary basis for these genes. So, for centuries, we've thought that heredity passes through your blood. You hear the terms bloodline, mixed blood, royal blood, but actually your blood is the only thing that doesn't carry DNA. It's not passed along. It doesn't carry DNA because it's the only cell in your body that doesn't have a nuclei. Now, surprisingly enough, genetically speaking, all races are equal. As a matter of fact, if you took a random sample of someone's DNA, just by looking at it, you could not tell whether they were African American, Caucasian, Asian, or any other race. Now, we've all heard about the Human Genome Project, but I bet you didn't know how much it cost. Since it began in 1990, the Human Genome Project has actually cost $3 billion. Now, if you look back as recently as the 1980s, you'll see that there was a rush to find a single gene that would explain schizophrenia, intelligence, dispositions to violence, homosexuality, and obesity. But since then, no single gene has been found. We now call these characteristics multifactorial, which means that it's a complex interaction of genes that are also affected by the environment. So, despite what you hear from the media, there's no gay gene, no IQ gene, not even a fat gene. In fact, no behavioral characteristic has ever been found to be a result of a single gene. For about 100 years now, we've been trying to link mental health disorders to genetics. First, we started with hereditary studies, and back in the 80s, we tried to link one single gene to a mental health disorder, but now we consider it multifactorial, meaning that a combination of genetic interactions with environmental triggers is what could explain mental health disorders. However, scientists have never been able to find a combination of genes with an environmental trigger to explain a mental health disorder. For example, many people think that ADHD is a multifactorial genetic disease. However, scientists have never been able to find a combination of genes with an environmental factor that accounts for ADHD.